Well, I don't think you ever believed that I'd take a boat out here on the Mississippi and get close to this shipyard to get the footage that I said I wanted to get.
I'll give you credit. You're absolutely right. I did not think you would actually go to that land.
Yeah.
But you have, and I'm glad you did, because I'm really confident we're going to end up capturing something unusual. That's no plane.
Tell us about the orbs.
Well, they've increased in number. What the ending craft type objects, the bright balls of light that hover in the sky for a long time, those have increased in number not only here but around the world.
So, okay, let's go on a safari here and hunt for these starbursts.
It's odd. But it's got a blinker that's flying around it, circling it right now.
What turned into an orb?
That was weird.
That helicopter.
What happened?
Did you get that?
He's got no engine noise.
Oh shit, here's an orb. Oh,
and it won't be
there you go.
Follow him.
I got him. Hey buddy.
They're all over the trees. Don't you see the faces?
Yeah. I pointed them out and he's
They're everywhere then. They are absolutely everywhere, all the time.
All the time, yeah. You just haven't noticed them.
No.
Cannot swords be turned to plowshares? Can we and all nations not live in peace? In our obsession with antagonisms of the moment, we often forget how much unites all the members of humanity. Perhaps we need some outside universal threat to make us recognize this common bond. I occasionally think how quickly our differences worldwide would vanish if we were facing an alien threat from outside this world. And yet, I ask you, is not an alien force already among us?
They're all over the trees. Don't you see the faces? I never thought when I come to New Orleans we'd have Pacific Northwest weather, but...
Well, here it is. Enjoy the weather here.
The weather kind of fits the mood of what you've been looking into for the last 4 months.
Yeah, but, I mean, that's the feel I'm getting, actually.
Well, Steve, after about 4 months of hounding me, you finally got me to fly out to New Orleans.
Yeah.
I don't normally do stuff like that, but you got me here, and the weather kind of a little bit gloomy, a little bit doomy, and it kind of fits the topic of what you've allowed yourself to get into over these last, how long has it been since you've been doing some of this filming?
It's been probably between 4 and 6 months.
4 and 6 months.
And it seems to be going in that direction.
You caught some amazing stuff that caught my attention, and so I had to come and investigate it for myself and make sure that, I get so many letters and so many things come through my email that I most of the time I just pass it off. Tell us a little bit about yourself, for starters. What have you been doing all these years in New Orleans?
Well, born and raised here, 52 years old at this point, and spent the last 20, 30 years doing electronics work for a company involved with oil and gas, seismic, marine exploration. But other than the 8 hour a day, effort I put in there, I have been involved with trying to document some of this phenomenon that's taken place.
So your camera was actually capturing things that your naked eye wouldn't see.
Exactly. And that's really what intrigued me, is what I was seeing in the downloaded footage I was not seeing with the naked eye, and I found that pretty unusual.
Tell us some of the things that you were seeing that were anomalies that you captured on your camera.
The original footage had a glowing ball of light that was in every single video that I ended up downloading. This ball of light was included. And there were a particular pattern of lights associated with it, which gave an outline to what would look like some sort of a craft or a vehicle. Once I saw that, I became intrigued because I realized something was there. And after a couple of weeks, I noticed a shipyard area that had a lot of activity as far as strange lights and some of these craft that I considered, you know, UFOs at the time, were always heading in that direction or involved in that area. So as I focused in on that area, I started to see the anomalies that I ended up catching.
Steve, one of the still shots you sent to me, I could actually see a crane with lights on it, and it looked like to me this kind of a craft. It was translucent, you could see through it.
You know, Ken, it's hard to explain. It's not just black and white. It just doesn't jump out at you. It's almost some kind of a, the way I put it, it's some kind of an interdimensional transference of one reality that seems to be bleeding into another, because you can pick up these shapes and these figures that are associated with these particular lights that you're speaking of.
When you say figures, are you talking about ships now or something?
I'm talking figures, characters.
What do you mean? What do you mean characters?
More related to animal type shapes or a humanoid type of a shape, a body figure or the physique of a humanoid type of a figure. And that intrigued me again. Once you'd see something like that, it wasn't just there, but if you looked close enough, you would see blending into the reality, you would see behind the scenes almost, see this anomaly, you know, coming in and out of focus, as if it was there, but wasn't in this realm.
If you and I went out tonight, okay, now that's why I'm here.
Right.
And I picked up a camera, and I started filming, and I don't know what I'm looking at, you're telling me that my camera would begin to pick up some of these things that you've been filming for the last 4 or 5 months.
I think, without a doubt, you would end up capturing the similar characters and anomalies that I'm picking up. It's not an effort. It's a matter of just filming what's there. And then when you download that and you actually take a little time and look at it closely and slowly and carefully, you'll start to pick up these subtle shapes and anomalies. And once you develop an eye for it, you'll see how easy it is to just, in this particular area, capture this activity.
Okay,
regardless.
So that's what I want to do. I want to go out tonight and maybe the next one.
Sure.
Because I have a couple days to be here
sure.
with you. And I want to film some of these things and see if what you're telling us is the truth.
I'm game. I would love the company because I've been doing it on my own. Yeah.
Okay, so you got a deal.
Sounds great. Tonight.
Great. Since we're in the French Quarter, the world-famous French Quarter, not far from Bourbon Street, let's go have some Cajun food.
Let's do it, Ken.
Today, we've come to Steve's house. He's graciously invited us in so that we can talk a little bit more intimately about some of the things he's discovered. You know, Steve, it's hard to get serious about this whole thing because it's so surreal. I mean, most people, when it comes to spiritual things like this, they kind of run. They don't want to think about it. They get frightened by it, or they get intimidated, or it's not part of their general thinking. So when we talk about spirituality and spiritual phenomena like this, It's hard to get it out and talk to people about it. I'd like to talk about some of the things that you've filmed and get into some of the specifics so that we can get a more detailed understanding of what is actually happening here and this phenomena that you say and what Google Earth is telling us is worldwide. What is very difficult to understand by the human mind is how holographic images seem to be able to work. We can't seem to wrap our mind around the idea that something can change from one form to another in this physical realm. We're used to seeing stuff like that in the movies, but in actuality, that's another story. What you're about to see will be a demonstration of how that can take place in the natural realm. And I believe this is the one where you and I were filming up on the levee the night I came into town.
Yep.
And you were directing our vision to these lights. And as we were shooting, something very amazing manifested through the lights. I don't understand how it all works. I'm at a loss. But somehow, morphing is done through these lights. Well, this is the image we caught, and it looks like a monk in a robe, in a robe that goes down to the feet, and you can see a beard on this entity, and it's almost Christ-like looking. It's an amazing image, and this is the one we shot the very first night I arrived, and we shot it from the levee that borders the Mississippi River. You know, as I look at this, I notice there's a dark being right here. You can see an outline, and another one right over here. So there's actually a being.
Wow, you're right.
Can you see those two?
Yeah, sure can.
So there's, it's interesting. As you look at this stuff, you begin to see other images, and it's not like your eyes are playing tricks on you. They're actually there. You just don't notice them until you look around and focus, and it's just amazing what's coming out of this light.
It's as odd as you can imagine, you know, when you see that kind of stuff.
Let's go to another one.
Sure.
Whoever or whatever is behind these remarkable images we're seeing seems to be able to use existent life forms to sculpt holographic images. There's three particular ones we'd like to call your attention to on this screen. One right in the center of the screen that kind of looks like the development of a human or humanoid. One at the lower left knee of that image, which looks like an owl or a frog. And one to the upper right of the screen that kind of looks like an animal, of a dog or something. In the first image in the center of the screen, it seems to be sculpted out of different lights that outline the torso and then the legs. As you can see, we're scrolling up and down with the arrow pointing out the torso of this particular thing. It's also at times impregnated with eyes that are quite large, and it seems as though this thing shapeshifts from the face of a man to almost like a devil look with huge eyes. This image seems to shapeshift continually throughout, but as you'll see, it's very interesting and quite remarkable. Here it can be clearly seen that the image has the face of a man, and the body again is outlined, as you can see, as it's pointed out by the arrows, all the way from the shoulders down to the right leg, all the way to the feet. And to the upper right corner, you can see the image looking down as though it's observing these two entities being formed. As we press on, the face begins to change to something more demonic looking and grotesque, almost like a mask that you'd see. And so what we're showing you is this imagery that seems to be sculpted. There's one with a very demonic face on it, as you can see. And now one with full of eyes. You can also see that the genital area is kind of covered over with a dark shadow, so you have no idea of the sexuality of this entity. Once again, in the upper right-hand corner, you see the face of, looks like a puppy dog there, watching in as these creatures develop. And it's quite fascinating and quite busy. There's one with the huge eyes in the center of the top of the head. There, one just alarmingly looking at us, and maybe even looking at the photographer that's shooting it. And then here, one impregnated with lights, again with huge eyes, and the dog looking down, or the face of that being in the upper right-hand corner looking down. What we've shown to this point are perhaps 20 images of holographic forms that comprise just a small portion of the numerous shots that we have of these strange things that we're seeing into the spiritual world.
Steve, explain what's happening here. Tell us what you're seeing.
And there's going to be a UFO that I noticed above
the porch, my neighbor's porch, and that's what I was concentrating on.
But you happen to notice an image that's being shot on this wall. So you're in the frame of mind, you're all catching all kinds of stuff, and there's an image on this wall. How does it there? This light's on, and all of a sudden we see this image, strange image on the wall.
Those images seem to manifest in the general area of a UFO. It affects tree lines, it affects a couple of different aspects of the reality that's in that particular area, that general area. Here is the UFO that I spotted over the, again, the neighbor's porch, trying to follow it as it was flying by. And here is a segment of that footage where I froze the frame and took a look at what was actually behind the light. And as I went frame by frame, I was just amazed at what I saw. It's just very interesting, and it's eye-opening. At this point, you can almost see a figure, a head type of a shape at the top of the light.
And then over here, what are we seeing over here?
Looks to me like another reptilian type of a head. It actually looks like it's looking around as frame by frame as you move forward. It looks like it's actually checking out the area.
Almost like that's the guidance system for the UFO, which is masquerading as an airplane.
And you mentioned it earlier that these seem to be entities actually morphing or disguising themselves as UFOs. And you're talking about something that deceives people.
That's a great shot right there of the UFO. And then that image that's being cast by this light, have you gone back to see if that image is there?
The image is not, and the image would not have been visible with the naked eye
at
the time.
That's right.
That's one of the keys. The image is never visible with the naked eye. What is visible are the lights, and they very well may be real in this physical realm.
Mm-hmm.
They tend to use those lights and morph from those lights.
Yeah. Using physical light to superimpose holographic images. You know, after seeing all of these things, all of these images, the Google Earth stuff, and even the stuff that I've shot, because I, you know, it's hard to accept this. It's unbelievable.
Absolutely.
You know, there's a scripture in the Bible that says, eat this book, it'll be sweet to your taste and bitter in your stomach. And that was a scripture that was given in the book of Revelation, in the 10th chapter, where John's eating this book. And the idea of it is that some of these things are really sweet. They taste good. They're interesting. You know, you want more. But when it comes to telling it, the telling of the spiritual world is difficult because people simply do not want to believe there's a spiritual world. And as you see these things, whether you want to believe it or not, it's certainly a fascinating, interesting phenomena that's happening, that speaks of a spiritual dimension that most people aren't even aware of or don't even want to consider. So you be the judge. You decide on what this means. Well, we're here with George Huber, who came down from Lafayette, Louisiana, here to the French Quarter in New Orleans. And as you can hear, there's a lot of ambient sound going on because we are in the French Quarter. But George, thanks a lot for coming all this way so we could interview you about your amazing experiences. Tell us a little bit about yourself and how you got involved with all these strange anomalies, not here in New Orleans, but actually in other parts of the United States.
Well, I've always been interested in the bizarre, I guess you could say. I used to be a reader about the pyramids and stuff coming up in high school. But when I started listening to Coast, I got into it a little bit more. And Coast to Coast kind of opened my eyes to a lot of things. And I just listened, and I was interested. I'd call in and make comments, but I had nothing to relate personally. So I actually prayed to the Holy Spirit to show me something, because I'm a Catholic and I had a reconversion to my religion, and I took it seriously for the first time. And for the first time, the Holy Spirit entered me and started answering me, and I was really shocked. And so it gave me a little bit more confidence. I said, well, show me something. Let me see the reality of this, because I'm tired of hearing about it from other people. I want to go see it myself. So as fate would have it, I was online and I saw this UFO Congress coming up in Laughlin. So I booked it immediately, and within 3 days I was over there in Nevada. And I had a roommate that they fixed up online. I didn't know him. I didn't know if I would be with a Martian or what, you know. So it was kind of weird, but we hit it off pretty good. And in the conference, I was taking some shots while the speakers were speaking, and I picked up these orbs for the first time. I never knew what an orb was.
When you say you picked them up, what do you mean by that?
I mean
that?
They captured them on digital camera.
Now, since that time, you've seen tons of stuff
right.
all over the place. And you've made some sketches
right.
of some of the things that you've shot.
Correct.
I want to look at some of these sketches, and then I want to look at some of your photographs.
Okay.
So let's get the sketches out here, and let's take a look at it.
Okay. Now this is what I regularly see on a nightly basis using Generation 3 night vision goggles. But when you combine the Generation 3 night vision with infrared spotlight.
Okay.
I have a 2 million candle infrared spotlight,
right.
which shoots up into the sky like a beam.
Okay.
You can't see it with your naked eye, but when you look through the goggles, it looks like an intense beam shooting through the sky.
Now, you broke this down, these objects into looks like about 8 categories, and then you've kind of put your own nomenclature on it. Why don't you explain to us a little bit about each one of these?
Okay. These are the different types of things that I regularly see at night. This here is what I call the snowflake. It has almost emerald-like qualities. This here is a flat mirror-like orb. It shines at you. It'll kind of get translucent and fade off into nothing. This is an orb in flight. It's actually a flat orb that when it travels in a certain direction, it folds back into a cone shape.
Mm-hmm.
And you can see them flying all through the sky. This here is an orb that will sometimes come right before you, and it'll flash these moving stripes. These stripes will move. And what I think this is just another version of all of this, which this here is a black centered orb. I've seen those, and they will also transform into this. And that will transform into this, and this will transform into that. This is a whirling spiral orb. This is the spiral that is kind of undone. It'll actually, when they move real fast sometimes, they'll kind of undo and then snap together again into another vortex spiral, which is what they seem to look like. They're a spiraling vortex.
Okay.
Is what they look like.
And these are the kind of the different orbs that you see.
I see this
regularly, whether it's in California or Louisiana.
Well, I haven't had the night vision goggles for very long, but I mostly see them in Louisiana because I go out every night in my backyard.
You're seeing these in your backyard?
In my backyard.
Amazing.
Right.
Okay, thanks for sharing that. I'd like to take a look at some of these other drawings that you have here.
All right, now these were all perceived in live vision. These here, some of these are digital photography. Like, I haven't seen anything like this in live vision, but I've seen it in digital shots, which orbs with smiling faces. I picked up in digital shots these luminous forms, abstract forms. They're super bright, and they seem to have little nodules and stuff inside of them. This here is like a bird-like flying orb, which a lot of people call a fairy. They do look a lot like fairies, but they don't have a face or anything. It's just a big, you can see it's so bright. It's just a big luminous thing, and it flies in front of you.
Okay.
This here is a amorphic luminous type that has like a combined face, a bunch of faces all tied into one.
Mm-hmm.
You might see one big overall face, and then you'll see little faces all jammed up in them, and some of them overlap. This here is a sinister orb because of the pitchfork and the disgruntled looking face.
I've actually seen this one. on a shed in my friend Steve's backyard. Looks exactly like this. It's very strange.
Yeah, maybe he's making road trips. But right here is another orb, and they seem to stick their tongue out at you.
This kind of looks like Richard Nixon right there.
Yeah, it does have that look.
And they actually stick their tongue out
at
you.
Yeah, they have a look. There's something about sticking their tongue out with these orbs. I've seen it many a times.
Okay.
That they stick their tongue out.
All right.
Ken, I got to show you one more thing, because this is what I call the grand finale. Now, we're familiar with the object that I told you about earlier.
Right.
Now, on this particular night in September or October, I got it written down. I came out and I saw this object floating out from my backyard. And I said, what's going on tonight? You know, and I kind of talked to it. It went up over the sky about maybe 50 feet up, and it put on a light show. This is what it did. It exploded into this. These bars, I would say, scale-wise, might be 20 feet. And super bright. If it would have been a firework display, it would have been an incredible 4th of July type thing.
This is in your backyard?
In my backyard.
And this is how many feet above your house?
30.
30 feet?
30 feet.
So it was specially for you?
It was me. It was for me.
Okay.
And this thing exploded, it shrunk, it did all kind of unbelievable shape shifting. This is what I, you know, these whirling cigar shapes, they expose themselves for the first time in this shot all together. It's almost like saying this is what we are, this is us together, all assembled. They shrunk back down into this and floated off to the northwest, and I haven't seen them since. They were saying goodbye, is what I think. Whether they'll come back, I don't know, but it was something directly communicated to me, and it's unexplainable.
I don't think you ever believe that I take a boat out here on the Mississippi and get close to this shipyard to get the footage that I said I wanted to get.
I'll give you credit. You're absolutely right. I did not think you would actually go to that length.
Yeah.
But you have, and I'm glad you did, because I'm really confident we're going to end up capturing something unusual.
As it turned out, Steve was more than right. We caught many startling anomalies. Here is a truly remarkable picture that was snapped just after we arrived at the Avondale shipyard. Keep in mind that we had a picture-perfect day with not a cloud in the sky. In fact, the early evening was totally clear, with visibility as far as the eye could see. And yet, when this picture was taken, there was a shroud of fog hanging over the shipyard. The camera captured something entirely different than what we were seeing, something supernatural. Then, superimposed on this fog, or as some called ectoplasm, was a face of an animal-like creature which seemed to be looking down and observing us. After this initial photograph, we began to capture pictures of strange orbs, not only over the shipyard, but all around us. Whatever it was we were trying to capture seemed to come from light sources utilized to create and superimpose images. Here on the side of a crane, for example, is a koala bear type image. And then what I consider an even more remarkable image of a type of stick man holding a tool.
You have a light. Let's take a look at this light. So when you shine that light, what does that do?
This produces a 2 million candle infrared spotlight.
And why is that important?
because in combination with the night vision,
yeah,
when you put the infrared light on, these orbs luminesce.
Okay, Jordan, now you were saying that it's this kind of lighting that seems to be a perfect lighting for what we're looking
right.
for.
Most of the activity that I come across starts taking place right about now, right when you're losing that day, that last thread of daylight.
Okay.
The night comes on.
And, so we should be in perfect position if we're going to see something.
We're going to see something, you know. I have seen some activity.
What are you seeing?
I'm seeing orbs light up and then go off.
The whole time while on board the ship, we seem to be attracting a great deal of attention and interest. Are the orbs benign or malevolent? This unnerving photograph may give us insight and provide an answer into this troubling question. Here it can be seen of an orb actually fixing itself to the back of Steve's head. Of course, it's only speculation, and as wild as it may seem, the orbs may be some kind of probe system sent out to gather information. In this remarkable picture, our friend George is being spotlighted and singled out as he is marked with a green and red light, first on his arm and then moving up and onto his face.
Coast Guard, we may get chased out of here. No, it isn't. Where'd the one over here go?
It turned into a plane and flew off.
He's tied on the ACL air hands, both the fleet, with one door.
That's no plane.
As we turned our boat and headed back up the Mississippi River several miles to our port, a strange visitor was shadowing our return and tracking our journey back home.
Now we're south of Phoenix, Arizona, about 2 or 3 miles from the city, and we're at the foothills of the South Mountains. There's some strange formations around here that we're going to be showing you, but I'm here with my new friend, Jeff Woolwine, who's been living here for most of his life and has been recording many of the things that we'll be seeing rock carvings of. Jeff, you've brought us to the foot of the South Mountains here, and there's some strange pyramid-like formations. I'm wondering what your take is on these pyramid shapes.
Well, as we go through the tour today, we will be seeing a lot of pyramid hill formations here. And when we study the pyramids, not only do we find pyramids around the world, whether they're man-made or whether they're natural-made, it seems like these pyramids are reference points to energy spots that actually attract these UFOs.
Now, you see these UFOs, I like your take on how you explain UFOs. You see them as not extraterrestrial, but actually interdimensional.
That's right, that's right. Going into this, studying this phenomenon, I was having an open mind. I was thinking spaceships, technology, other planets that they come from. But as I started watching these things over the years and studying them and actually seeing them, I'm more inclined to believe that they actually reside here. It's more interdimensional. They're, instead of extraterrestrial, it's interterrestrial, if you will.
Okay.
And the Native Americans explain that these hills, these mountains are sacred because their spirits reside.
So you're going to take us on a tour where we're going to see some of the wall paintings and rock paintings that have been left by Indians that have had experiences with some of these things that have been here for a long time.
That's right. We'll be overlooking some petroglyphs that has been carved anywhere from 900 years old to possibly close to 1,000 years old. And it depicts what they were seeing in the sky. They didn't have video cameras back then. They had stone boulders to record.
They recorded their sightings on stone.
Okay. That's right.
Fantastic.
What we are about to see is a great volume of dynamited rock. Jeff believes that it was the CCC under FDR that was trying to cover up a great mystery.
The CCC was established during the 1930s, during Franklin Roosevelt. They decided to boost the economy and to clean up the park. They did a lot of gold mining. Matter of fact, they pulled at least $60,000 worth of gold off this mountain, along with copper and some crystals and stuff. And they also did some devastation to some of the rock art here. And I believe that, as you can tell, all this blown up rock here. And then when you look straight up, you can see a petroglyph. The deers, all right, the animals, the carvings here are very significant. When we see a deer carving or a coyote carving, it's always looking in the sacred spot to where to find these UFOs at, or spirits, according to the Native Americans. So when we look at that deer, he's looking up the hill there, and when you look a little bit further, you can see on how the CCC destroyed that part of the story.
Well, now, I want to go up there and take a closer look at these petroglyphs, but my question to you is, why would the CCC want to destroy the story? What would their motivation be?
Well, I think there's a few explanations on this. One, when Phoenix was pretty much established, they were looking for gold. Now, a lot of people say, well, you know, you won't find a lot of gold nuggets here. True, but what they were failing to look at is gold was brought here by the Mayans.
And for what? Why would the Mayans bring gold here?
Well, to use it for their sacrificing rituals. They would melt the gold down to make gold idols in replicas of what their spirits that they've seen in the sky as a type of idol worship.
One thing that strikes me when we talk about spirits in the sky, I think I'm a lot like most people. This is a mythology. These people were, you know, just high on peyote or something, and they came up with all these strange ideas about the spirit in the sky. But these things that you're talking about actually physically manifest. They don't cast shadows, as you say, but you actually have pictures of some of these spirits in the sky. I've seen some of them. So they weren't just making up stories because they were high on peyote. They were actually seeing these manifestations of things. So is the cover-up that you're talking about the attempt by the CCC to cover over the story so that people wouldn't dig up these idols that they made after these spirits?
I believe so. That's right. That's right. Some of these rock art panels depict what is buried within the mountains here. So in destroying the story, destroying the rock art of it showing what's buried
here, it would discourage people from trying to dig them up.
That's right. Mm-hmm.
So you still think they're buried here?
Absolutely.
Okay.
Absolutely.
Let's go to some of those places. I'm not into digging them up. I don't want to get King Tut mad at me.
Yeah.
But anyway, this is very interesting.
If you notice right down in here, right, you can see how the CCC, okay, you can see the dynamite sticks there. They implanted dynamite sticks to blow up the rocks, and here we can see some more dynamite sticks there. Okay, now you'll notice that it's right on some petroglyphs. We have a deer here, okay? Now, in my studies, I'm coming to find out on studying the petroglyphs here, the animals, for instance, the deers or the coyotes, are always looking in sacred places to where to find these spirit beings at, to where some of the doors are, and also some of these sacred objects that are buried here within the mountains. They're forever looking at sacred places. So this deer here, now he's kind of looking up at a diamond spiral, okay? Now these spirals represent doorways for these beings. Now, we find spirals here on South Mountain. 20% of them are water, natural watering holes. But the majority of them here on South Mountains are doorways for these supernatural beings. Here, we have what looks like, what the Indians like to say, a lizard man, okay? And the story on these lizard men is when the Ho'okam first arrived here, they didn't know how to live here in the desert. So these creatures came up out of the sand world. They looked just like us. They lost their tails, and they were able to teach the Native Americans how to live. And when they were done teaching them, they went back down into the sand world and promised to return someday. Now, some of the Native Americans here, when you ask them, because you will see that little dot in their belly. You see the dot in their stomach there? Now, some of the Native Americans will say, well, that's our spirit, and he's halfway in the rock and halfway out of the rock. He's coming out of the rock. But in my studies on watching these UFOs, I believe that dot there is an orb. This is what we're seeing in the sky today. And actually what this orb is doing is he's transforming into a man. He's representing a man. He's actually morphing into a human. So that dot in the belly there is actually a UFO orb, and he's morphing into a man.
While the Ho'okam Indians recorded on rock faces their supernatural encounters, self-serving men tried to hide the story, annihilating their records by blasting them under a mountain of rock. But as we shall see, the Ho'okam story would not lay dormant under the debris of men's devices. The story has been recovered, and the truth, for our benefit, has been restored by Jeff Woolwine's incredible investigation and patient observations. But even more importantly, and more impressively, we shall see that these strange sightings long ago recorded on rock are still being seen to this day here on South Mountain.
These are the pictures that they drew. They drew on rocks. They didn't have cameras. They drew what they saw on rocks as a records, as a record of
what
they were experiencing in this Phoenix thing. Is Phoenix a valley? Would you call it a valley?
Yeah, it's the Valley of the Sun.
Valley of the Sun.
Phoenix, some people think it's, you know, Phoenicians, uh-huh. The land of the giants,
because
we find a lot of petroglyphs here that depict giants, and a lot of evidence that the giants were here in Phoenix, Arizona through the rock art. And it wasn't just graffiti that they were doing, but they were actually telling a story of something important.
What's going on with this one?
Here we find what looks like a lizard guy, because we have a tail here and we have his legs, and you can see that he's in the appeasement pose, much like what us sky watchers do. We look up and we're like, hey, you know, what are you? Come and see us. And here is a depiction of what looks like a worm or a creature, okay? And this is the type of stuff that we're looking for here in the Valley of the Sun. In my opinion, it's not a craft, but another life form. It's another creature. And this is actually depicting of what this Native American saw in the sky. And if you look up right over here, you can see another one there, all right? Now, I've videotaped this. I've seen that creature there Easter Sunday of 2009.
You have a picture of that, a video of it?
That's right, mm-hmm.
This is an amazing rock here. Why don't you explain this one to us?
Here we have on this panel many spirals, and here's one representing it as it's going down, which means that the doorway for the spirits is in the ground here. We have another spiral, seems to be representing it's going up. So not only do we have a doorway on the ground, but we also have a doorway in the sky. We have a coyote, or a deer, if you will, and he's looking up at what we might think is a spiritual being, okay? We have this worm here. What we're looking at is actually photographs of what these creatures look like. I've seen these worms in the sky here. Over here, we have a bow tie. And some of the petroglyphs here, these bow ties actually grow legs and arms and a head. And this is representing a spirit being, a UFO, if you will. On top here, you'll see that this is oriented on top, in the sky. This is one of these serpent creatures that I filmed many times here in Phoenix, Arizona. And it's up high, or it's as to say that it's been seen in the sky here. He's a very powerful entity. This is one of my favorite panels here. This panel right here really depicts on what the Indians are trying to say here of South Mountain. When you look at the rock art here, you're not just supposed to look at the art here, but actually what the artist is trying to tell us. And he's trying to tell us that the art is depicting the back of the landscape here. It's depicting the whole landscape. Here we have this formation here, okay? Now this represents the two pyramids that are behind us. This pyramid represents this pyramid here, and there's another pyramid that we will see on the other side there. Now, if you look, the pyramids is in the shape of a serpent. Okay, this is a serpent making these two pyramids. So the Indians are trying to tell us that there's a serpent, a big serpent, that dwells within these two pyramids here. On top, between the two valleys of the pyramids, comes up and is this creature here. This is a UFO spirit creature. And to the left of him is the sun. So when the sun is in the right position, it opens up the two doorways of the pyramids for these spirit beings.
You know, Jeff, words form pictures in people's minds. And when it comes to the word spirit, people have no idea what to do with a mind picture for the word spirit. And so I think for most people, I think it's fair to say that most people think of something in the air just flying through the air, but which has no form. But as we look at these things, and as I look at some of the film you've shot, what these Indians called spirits actually had form. They could see them with their eyes.
That's right.
They were really strange looking things.
That's right.
And I'm glad you've done this work over the last 5 years. Learning to understand what this rock art was all about in relationship to what you've seen here in this Phoenix Valley. It is remarkable. There is a spiritual world that actually has form.
That's correct.
And these Indians and the people that lived here were actually experiencing these forms as they looked in the sky, and that's why they wrote them down here on these rocks.
While we were filming this segment, we inadvertently captured on film a spirit anomaly. Watch carefully as it appears out of nowhere and rapidly accelerates upward.
You know, studying these UFOs and watching them for many years, I've come to find out that these things like energy spots, power plants, seem to be the intergalactic gas station, if you will. I noticed that these UFOs would actually hover over some electrical power plants, and sometimes they would gather up so much energy that they would start to steam. And studying this type of phenomenon, I'd come to find out that these mountains, South Mountain is one of them, was created by a fault line. And these fault lines generate a type of energy. And this would explain on the reasons why these UFOs like mountains so much, especially the ones with the fault lines, is because they're absorbing the energy that the fault lines are producing. And along with these fault lines, and some people like to call them ley lines, we find pyramids. And these pyramids, whether they're natural phenomenon pyramids or if they're man-made pyramids, we find them on certain spots around the world that harnesses or attracts energy. And this is the reason why the UFOs like these pyramids so much, is because they're sitting on top of energy markers, ley lines, or fault lines.
It's obvious from the wall art that the Holocom had no love relationship with the numerous spirits in the sky. But why?
This is what I believe to be an altar. And on the back side of this altar, we find Mayan or Aztec art. Now, clearly, this is art that we find on the pyramids of Mexico. And we have these what look like orbs, okay? And they're connected together. Now, I've seen a lot of these orbs together like this, and they actually are connected, okay? As to say, they're like, they're connected together. And I believe when they do this, they're either interacting with each other or they're absorbing each other's energy by connecting themselves together. When we come around to the front side of this altar, we can clearly see on how this has been carved out. This whole panel here, along with this here, has been carved out. And we find stains, okay, that seems to be dripping off of this altar. Before they did their sacrifice, if you notice, it's right at a dried up riverbed. And what they used to do is they used to purify themselves first by washing themselves in the water before they did the sacrifice on the altar. And according to the legends here, when the sacrificing had stopped, that's when the spirits got uneasy and they got upset. And that's when the land started to dry up. The Ho'okam didn't worship the sun, but they felt the sun was a tyrant god. And they felt that if they had stopped the sacrifice, that the sun god would get mad and would send his Valley of the Sun, his sun devils, to come down and to do whatever they wanted to do with the people. Here we find a stick figure guy with four arms, and he has this magical staff weapon, if you will. And he's shooting at this serpent in the sky. The sacrificing did stop, and that's when the land, according to the story, became dry and desolate, and that's when the Ho'okam ended up disappearing.
You know, as I look back behind us over here, it looks like all these rocks were just pushed over something.
And that's right.
It's hiding something. Mm-hmm. What is it hiding? What do you think is buried there?
Something very significant is within this pyramid hill here, whether it's gold tombs or whether it's a buried Mayan king. But something very significant, very special, is buried within the walls here.
The people that would try to hide something like this would not want people to be looking for gold. Gold idols unto the alleged gods that the Indians saw. So perhaps it's a tomb where there's golden idols hidden.
That's correct. That's correct. And in studying this phenomenon here, and in studying the myths of South Mountain, we should find many tombs with many gold idols representing the spirits that was seen in the sky.
Well, listen, we've had a great trip, and I'm really thankful that you've allowed us to come out here and
thank you so much.
Find out all about your studies, 5 years of research into this South Mountain. And I think it confirms to, and will confirm to many people, that there really is a spiritual world, and it's not just invisible stuff. It's stuff that manifests in forms and dimensions, and I think it's pretty conclusive. So thanks for having us.
Thanks for coming out.
We've come across the country to Pennsylvania, to the home of Allison Cruz, whose young daughter Emily discovered a strange aircraft flying over their house, and which subsequently led her mother Allison into some astounding discoveries.
We're sitting here with Allie Cruz in her home, and she's done remarkable research into these strange anomalies that we're seeing all over the world, all over the United States. And so we've flown out here to Pittsburgh to have a chance to chat with her and discuss some of the work that she's so graciously shared with us. Allie, thank you for having us in your home. I really appreciate it. You have a lovely home. Why don't you take us outside and let's look at this place in the daylight, and maybe you can point out some of the things they do, and then we'll come back tonight and we'll film.
And I just want to stress that
this is not the only patch, and I've discovered by driving around that it's just all around this area.
Well, Allie, we're looking out over the, I guess you call it the little valley here, which is loaded with trees. And why don't you explain to us where you tend to see these things manifest?
Well, the majority of the places that they like the most, they like this area down at the end there. There's no homes there, it's just woods. There's a big empty field. It's supposed to be the back nine of a golf course that never got finished. And the hills beyond that, it's mostly wooded. They like that hill.
In fact, what interested me about your work was something I saw on YouTube, where I saw some light form down in that valley down below there begin to rise up in front of the trees. It kept going up and up and up, and when it got to the tree, I started seeing blinking lights, and then it seemed like it turned into an airplane to me.
Yeah.
And I'm hopeful that you can fish that picture out for me so that we can share with the people how these things are like chameleons. They actually pretend that they're something they're not. To tell us about the orbs. We haven't talked much about the orbs. I've seen them down in New Orleans. I've seen them in Lafayette. Tell us about these orbs that you're filming almost continuously every night.
Well, they've increased in number. What the ending craft type objects, the bright balls of light that hover in the sky for a long time, those have increased in number not only here but around the world. Downtown Moscow, that kid's filming them. A lot of times they're coming out of a park where there's woods there. Mm-hmm. They're probably hiding in there. He's confirmed that they start out as these little bubble-sized things also there. I can give you his phone number if you want it.
Yeah, I want to contact him because you're in touch with a lot of people around the world that are reporting on this.
Yeah.
And so you're saying that there's been an increase in these orbs.
Yeah.
And it's a tough question I'm going to ask you. What do you think they are?
I'm not sure if they're the entity itself. A lot of people want to know, what kind of aliens or whatever that they are, and I don't know until I see them. Now, these little thin, clear bubbles, maybe that's a travel container, maybe they're inside that, maybe that's a remotely controlled probe of some sort. Maybe there's no living thing in there, maybe they have a mothership up top.
It's like a robotic
probe or
something.
Yeah, they might be able to, see everything and direct these things around without any danger, I don't know.
We're here with Michaeline and Lou from New Jersey, and I'm glad you could come out here and visit with us and share with us your experience with these things we're hearing about from all over the earth now, all over the planet. One of the things that impressed me, because I've seen some of your stuff, was the shots of the orbs, and we've seen a lot of that. But what impressed me about your stuff is that you shot it in the winter, when it looked like it was very cold, because one of the big criticisms of the orb hunters, if you want to call us that, I guess I qualify for that now, but is that, well, no, these are bugs and you're mistaking it. These are anomalies from digital cameras. But this was shot in the winter. And how do you respond to these people that are criticizing you, because I'm sure you get a lot of criticism, when they say these are just merely bugs?
What I would do is I would look up information about bugs in New Jersey in the winter. A really good example is bats hibernate because they don't have a food source in the winter. They eat bugs. So if there's if there's no insects or bugs, then, So I mean, that's proof right there. I have several links that state that they will come out during the day if it's warm above 30 on winter days. But I don't film during the day. I haven't. I wait until it's cold.
One of the films that you sent me was this. It looked like the way it was moving across the screen from right to left. I can't exactly remember the shape of it now, but it seemed like a barbell shape or some kind of, looked like a inchworm. That was really amazing shot. Can you explain that to us or describe it to us?
Well, that's a pretty good description. That's what I called it, the inchworm, because it really did move like an inchworm. And I have no explanation for it. Since then, I've gotten several different types of orbs or nighttime anomalies, creatures. We don't really know what they are.
And explain that one.
Well, Lou, you, what did you think when you saw that particular thing? There's no explanation for it.
No explanation.
See, that's the kind of stuff I like to film, because when people can try to explain it away, well then, you know, who knows, who can say? But when you have no explanation, there's no answers, to me, you have a credible piece of footage. You explain several of these things that I haven't seen yet that you've recorded.
So as I was filming at the Andover Airport, something else that was of interest, Lou spotted another craft coming in towards the left. And when it was approaching us, it was over the treetops, you know, very low. We didn't hear any engine noise. But this one looked different. It had four white lights in the front. And as it flew over us, you could see the bottom of the craft. And what it looked like to me was two boomerangs back to back. So almost like one, two, three, four, five lights, which isn't, you don't get those type of light, you know, configurations from a normal plane. So, you know, we thought that was kind of strange.
In your view, would you cast them as good or evil?
Not good.
Not good.
Not a good presence. No.
Not a good presence.
Don't like.
So
that.
Not good is evil.
Yeah, I guess so.
But
yeah.
you don't want to go to the word evil. You're just saying not good.
Yeah.
It's okay. Because of the massive amounts that we're seeing sometimes.
You know, it's almost an intuitive thing with me anyway.
Yeah.
My intuitive sense is that they're not good. They're not good.
Okay. Well, listen, you guys. Is there anything else while we're here that maybe I haven't covered or we haven't talked about at this point that you'd like to share with us that maybe be helpful to people that are listening in?
Oh, gosh.
Look at the sky.
Yeah.
Pay attention.
Evan Bradbury, a colleague of Ali Cruz, took us to the big screen, preparing us for that evening's foray into the world of anomalies in Murrysville, Pennsylvania.
We were all compelled to film it just because it didn't sound right, and as you can see, the lighting was very strange on it. And of course, there's all kinds of
blinking.
Yeah, exactly.
So if there's a blinking thing around something like that, would that indicate that it might be not of this world's technology?
Generally speaking, yes, from what I've witnessed.
So it may or may not be a helicopter. We're not sure of that.
We are not sure of that. That's correct.
There's another one, a couple more of those
blinkers.
Yes,
they're up there very, 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 what seems like it's very high. It's almost impossible to tell, you know, when you're looking at little points of light. But, you know, we see they're all over the place.
Thank you. As you can see, I've got my super duper binoculars here, and I'm with Eben, and we're in Pennsylvania, and we're going to go look at some things. What you call starbursts? You've discovered it
well,
with Alan.
That, well, that's the first part. The most impressive bit is the big amber light.
And you've got these tremendous weapons and tools that we're
when
using.
It rains.
You've got a new camera we're going to use tonight. So okay, let's go on a safari here and hunt for these starbursts.
Odd. But it's got a blinker that's flying around. It's circling it right now.
Got another low fly.
Yeah, this is not the first time I've seen it. It doesn't show up every night. It shows up at different times. Sometimes at dusk, it's the brightest thing out there, right above the horizon. You know, there's still light out just as it's getting dusk. Really bright. I mean, you can't not notice it. It doesn't show up every night. And shows up at different times. Sometimes at night, as this orange thing right here we're looking at. You can only see it in the night vision. It's right there in the center of the screen. Little blink that's been hanging around this guy. Oh, did you see that orb? I just caught a beautiful orb.
Did you?
Yeah, shot down straight over the tree line.
Did you get a film?
Here's that helicopter. Doesn't quite look like a helicopter.
What the heck was that blinking thing?
I'm going back to it.
Well, we're seeing
some. Oh, here we go. Here's two.
There's two of them?
Mm-hmm. Oh, this one doesn't even have a physical mass to it. On the one on the left here. Just there.
He just changed his wing light. I told you.
What turned into an orb?
That was weird.
That helicopter.
What happened?
Did you get that?
He's got no engine noise.
Oh shit! Here's an orb. Oh.
And it won't be
there you go.
Radar.
Follow him.
I got him. Hey, buddy. Hey, where are you going?
Kind of action out by us.
Hey.
Hey, I got you.
This kind of action out
there. I'm going to lose him the light here. There he is.
He's going fast.
This one's barely going anywhere. Where's he going? Hey.
This plane over here is interesting because there's absolutely no sound coming out of it.
Yeah, I still got this orb. Hang on.
Just a second. Give me the vocabulary again, Mikey.
We've got plasma balls, blinkies, orbs, fakers.
Disco balls.
Disco balls. A whole bunch. I don't know. We just make them up as we go along.
Looks like that the faker plane. We have certain terminologies for these now that we didn't know about before, but it has no engine noise. There's a lot of little flashing lights about it.
Those are blinkers.
Oh, excuse me, they're called blinkers.
Blinkies.
And it looks like this phony plane is turning around. And it might be heading back our way. We'll see in just a minute if it's coming this way.
Oh, look at this.
What is it?
Here's an orb. That's it.
Yeah.
Hello.
Good shot.
Here we go.
What I'm saying is that we've been filming a planet. We thought it was a planet, or it looked like a planet. Of course, Allie said, don't even think it's a planet. It's not. I looked at it through binoculars, and it was red. And Evan says he's seen it before. And then as we filmed it, it disappeared. It just went away.
Mars is back.
Yeah, Mars is back.
No, he's definitely not there. And he's got a blinker above him. And then it's headed lower and smaller.
I've never seen a planet behave like this, and it's not moving like a plane.
Describe the colors.
And it's still red, I'm assuming. I don't have my infrared on or my goggles on.
It's amber.
It's definitely coming towards us.
It's a very turning to the left now. Okay. There he goes. Now he's blinking. He's in his blinky phase. And he's going to the left. So these things act like they're lost. Oh, there's another little guy. He picked up a friend.
Turn back. What is that?
It's what?
There's a face in there. You see? Look up. Center of your screen, don't you see?
It's like a dragon face.
No. It's a woman's face. It's what we see in New Orleans. Tilt up.
I think you got
they're all over the trees. Don't you see the faces?
Yeah.
You see what I'm saying? Now look at that one. That's like a human face right there.
Yeah.
You see what I'm saying?
Oh, holy shit.
Are you recording that?
Yeah, I'm recording.
Are you here, Allie?
Yeah.
Come here. Take a look in this, and you'll see this face. Don't drop it. Do you see it, Allie? Right there. There's a face. There's a... No, it's not moving. It's still. It's looking out through the trees.
It's got a tongue in the middle there,
where
too.
Where did that woman's face go? We lost it.
Let's see his
tongue. That's right.
Oh, that's
two eyes and a nose. It's a huge, very frightening face. This middle with the two eyes.
That's right.
The mouth.
Yeah, that's right.
I see that.
They're in the trees, and this is what they do. They use this. They use these shadows. They're everywhere. Yeah, this is what Steve's been seeing down there, and this is what. There's one up in the tree, the top of the tree there. See it?
Well, we won't know what to film next now.
Well, this is interesting stuff. That lady's face, the woman's face.
This right here.
Yeah, there's
woman's
another
face.
That's right.
That's not a woman anymore.
Did you see that? It shifted
out.
Yeah,
it changed the shadows.
Yeah, it changed the shadows, and now it's got that long face. You see it?
Yeah, look how big the chin is now.
Look at the eyes on the top, right in the center of the screen.
They're not happy.
Are these faces loading themselves in these orbs and flying away in craft?
I don't think so. I just think that they're just like a signature.
I pointed them out and
they're everywhere then. They are absolutely everywhere all the time.
All the time, yeah. You just haven't noticed them.
No.
Allison Cruz is an amazing lady, and she's got literally hundreds of friends all over the world. We're with a man, Dan Page, and he's got quite a story to tell us. Thanks for coming to share with us your interesting tale.
We saw these lights stationary at the base of the tree, so clearly on the ground. We decided to walk down there and take a look. You know, I thought, I have to see what that is. You could barely see the lights, but through the infrared, they were there. I told everybody just to film that I have to go down there and look. So I trekked down into the woods with a flashlight, my camcorder, which is just a tape recorder. It's not a high def, but I decided I was gonna go down in the woods. I just had to see what was going on there. And you know, I believe things like this exist, but I have to see it for myself. And to get to the truth, you have to eliminate as many things as you possibly can. That's what spurred me to go down there. And I really wanted to go by myself because if something happened, I didn't want to have to try to watch over or trip over somebody on the way out. So I went down in the woods with my camera running.
On the power line, to your left. Okay. Can you see my light? Maybe
wreck. You're sitting in front of me.
Okay, just keep talking to me. I'm getting chilled now.
There you
go. I've moved that way.
Okay, we're standing right in front of you. I'm watching you go up. You're moving to my left.
Okay. I'm probably 40 or 50 feet away from where I saw them. They just disappeared. I want to keep moving right directly toward them.
You got a light over your head.
Yeah.
Do you see the light? Yeah. There's an orb over your head.
Really?
Yes.
Well, I'm more worried about these light bulbs right now.
Oh, yeah.
Okay, I got my camera running.
Yeah, I would run your camera because they're watching you.
Yeah, something's going on.
Yeah. How many, the eyeballs, were they up on the cable line?
No, they're about halfway up the tree. I guess they were eyeballs. Two, maybe three pairs of them. They almost looked like they were...
Okay, right above your head, right above your head. Look above your head. There's an orb up in a tree. A little to your right where you just had the flashlight.
Right there?
Yeah, over that way. There's a light shining through that tree.
Let me look.
It's pretty big.
I want to keep an eye on whatever this is back here. What?
It's big. You know, I can't see it with my eyes, but the scope is seeing it. It might be an incognito. Yeah, it's invisible.
It's in the trees.
It's behind some branches. It's not like it's gonna drop on your head.
Is it on this tree?
No, go over to your left a little more. Okay, you're closer right there. You just went past it. Okay, now put your flashlight away from us. Down the tree a little bit. Okay, you're not hitting it. You're to the right a little bit. Okay, now it just went out. Because you hit it.
Okay. I'm going to turn the flashlight
on.
Hold on.
Okay, it moved. It moved because you hit it.
I can't see it at all.
Yeah, you can. It's hiding.
The light actually withdrew into the tree. I don't know if the light dimmed or the leaves wrapped around it. It hit itself from the beam of my flashlight. When I took the beam away, it came back out. It was actually after the fact. We actually saw some quite remarkable images on the tape. It actually still gives me chills, but you can see clearly something. And I swear to you, it's not an animal. I can't explain what it is, but there is a ball of light, a craft, or something with energy within it, lit up on the ground, and there's at least one being behind the tree, and you can see it looking back and looking around the tree as I'm moving around in the woods.
Well, George, the last time I saw you was on the Mississippi River, and I remember a couple of pictures we took of you where we had some color on your arm, some red and green.
Right.
And then it moved up to your head, on the side of your face. And I showed that to you, and you didn't seem like it bothered you too much. But then I remember you had a different reaction when we took the camera off you. So how do you feel about that particular thing? I think you've thought about it since then.
I didn't feel anything at the time, so I didn't know I was being marked.
Of course,
so,
yeah.
Since you did point it out to me, it makes me wonder. It does make me wonder as to the nature of this thing. You know,
right.
You know, it's an invisible spectrum. We don't know.
Right.
I don't think there's anybody really knows what they're messing with. I've talked to a lot of researchers. They don't really know what they're coming across. Everybody has their hunches.
I thought, you know, from all the reports I got from all over the country and around the world, actually, that there were special places where this was happening. So I went out to New Orleans twice. I went to Phoenix. And then I went to Pittsburgh, and we saw some amazing things. And now you've come out here to prove to me that they're everywhere, because now we're in my backyard.
Correct.
And we're going to film tonight some orbs flying all over the place in my backyard in Eugene, Oregon.
Correct.
So we're going to need to take your infrared goggles.
Well, night vision goggles, night generation 3.
Generation 3 night vision goggles and an infrared
spotlight.
How much power is in that light?
It's a 2 million candle power.
Okay, so let's go take some pictures of the orbs in my backyard.
Sounds good.
That's cool.
See, they're up high, and then they'll come down, and you'll catch them in the light. Try to catch the bright one, and he'll kind of stop and be amazed by the light. They seem like they're very inquisitive.
Oh, they're a beauty.
Yeah. What I'm doing is shooting through my night vision goggles with my camera so that I'm catching the night vision through the lens of my camera, and then I'm shining the 2mm IR spotlight at the same time, and I'm tracking the beam of the spotlight, and I'm picking up the orbs. It's a still night, and they're curious. They come up to the light to kind of check out what the light's all about, and you can see them in the camera pretty well.
Are they high up or down low, or?
Well, they're high up, but you kind of have to scan around. They're curious, like I said, and they will come in closer for another look. And you also see them high, flying by, sort of like they're en route to somewhere else. That is freaking weird. Yep. That is strange.
That is a strange, very, very odd.
Yeah,
that's very strange. So we're seeing like individual orbs, we're seeing tons of orbs.
Let's see,
see what you got there.
There you go.
Well, George, I think from what we've filmed tonight, it's pretty convincing proof that these things are everywhere, including my own backyard. In fact, they're in everybody's backyard and probably in your house and everywhere. Something's going on that we just simply can't explain yet. So I want to thank you for being involved in this presentation and helping the world know what's really going on, but we can't see and understand. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Ken. I really enjoyed it.
Whether or not Ronald Reagan understood the magnitude of the invasion that he referred to in his famous speech to the United Nations in the 1980s is today just an academic question. But for sure, what we've just witnessed is very difficult for the human mind to understand. But what do I think? What do I believe? I believe we have looked into the realm of the dark stars, the fallen angels, as mentioned in the book of Revelation, chapter 12, a realm that has insinuated itself into every fabric and thread of human life, into our economics, our religions, our political realm, education, and even science. A good example of that is in the emerging field of transhumanism. But I think the Apostle Paul had it right some 2,000 years ago when he wrote to the people in Asia Minor and said, "For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities and powers, against spiritual wickedness in high places, against the rulers of this age." I'm Ken Klein.